Dear students, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjali Ammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Koyilvanni. I am happy to meet you again through the video lecture series on the subject Engineering Thermodynamics. And this is module number 8, Thermodynamic Relations. And this lecture is lecture number 3 on Thermodynamic Relations. So the topic is Thermodynamic Relations Part 3. And we recap from the previous lectures. So in the first two lectures on thermodynamic relations, we derived the Maxwell's relations, TdS equations and energy equation. And in this lecture, the topics are, we will be discussing about Joule-Thomson coefficient or Joule-Kelvin effect. And we derived the Clausius-Clapeyron equation, which is used to define the phase change process. And the learning outcome for the lecture, the student will be able to explain the Joule-Kelvin effect, and the student will be able to derive the Clausius-Clapeyron equation for phase change process. And this is one experiment to explain the Joule-Kelvin effect or Joule-Thomson expansion. And it is a throttling process. So it is a throttling device. We have a throttling device with a valve. And at the entrance, before the throttling process, we measure the pressure with the help of a pressure measuring instrument, and we measure the temperature, and the initial pressure is Pi and the initial temperature is indicated by Ti. And after the expansion, after the throttling expansion, we have the measurement for temperature and the pressure. So the Tf is the final temperature and the Pf is the final pressure. And the throttling device is completely insulated, so there is no heat transfer possible between the system and the surrounding, and there is no work done, so it is only expansion. So the fluid, the gas which is entering here, using the throttling valve, the pressure is regulated and it is expanded. So this is called as throttling expansion. And we draw a plot between temperature and pressure for different throttling setting. So before throttling, this is what the initial pressure, and we measure the, for different valve setting, we measure the final point 1, final point 2, final point 3, and we find the temperature pressure. Actually, when you regulate, the pressure decreases, temperature increases, and the temperature, the pressure, temperature takes the maximum value, then the temperature decreases. So the pressure keep on reducing. So we completely regulate. So initially we have the full opening and we reduce the pressure. So we regulate the flow. So the pressure decreases. And if you look at, the temperature is increasing, and here the temperature is maximum, then the temperature decreases. And this is the variation of temperature and pressure. And this curve is called as isenthalpic states of gases. So the, for a perfect gas, H equal to T. T is the temperature and H is the enthalpy. So this is the isenthalpic states of the, so the different points are called as isenthalpic state of the constant. And this curve is called as isenthalpic curve. So this curve is called as isenthalpic curve. And throughout the line, the enthalpy is constant. So for the expansion process, enthalpy is constant. Now we draw different lines. We draw a constant enthalpy curve for different opening, different conditions. And we have in every curve, so this is the one curve where you have the maximum point, where the, this is again, this is the maximum point, this is the maximum point, this is the maximum point. And here we have the maximum point, and here we have the maximum point. So for constant enthalpy curve, we draw different constant enthalpy curve. And in all the enthalpy curve, there is a maximum point. And through the maximum point, what is the maximum point? Slope equal to zero. So the slope is called as the slope equal to zero. So here the slope equal to zero, here the slope equal to zero. From all the maximum points, you draw one curve. That curve is called as inversion curve, where mu equal to zero. So the inversion curve, so where mu equal to zero, what is mu equal to zero? This is called as inversion curve. So numerical value of slope of isenthalpy in TP coordinate right, where is the at any point. So the actually the numerical value of the slope of isenthalpy in TP coordinate at any point is called as Joule-Kelvin coefficient and denoted by mu j. So if you look at here, so you calculate mu j here, so slope of the line is called as Joule-Kelvin coefficient, and here mu j equal to 0, and this is called as minus mu j. So here the slope is negative and here the slope is positive. So left hand side of the inversion curve the slope is positive, and right hand side of the inversion curve the slope is negative, and this is called as heating region and this is called as cooling region. So this is the critical point of the line, and the locus of all points of mu j is called as inversion curve. That is what the inversion curve. So the locus of all point where mu j equal to 0 is called as inversion curve, and the region inside the inversion curve mu j is positive and it is called as cooling region, and region outside the mu j it is called as heating region. So this is the heating region and this is the cooling region. That is what given here, and the mu j is differentiate, I mean dou T by dou P at constant enthalpy. So this is what called as the Joule Kelvin coefficient, dou T by dou P, that is the slope of the curve at constant enthalpy. This is what Joule Kelvin coefficient. And the Clausius-Klaproth equation. So this Clausius-Klaproth equation is derived for the phase change. What is phase change? Already we discussed melting, vaporization, sublimation. What is melting? Liquid to vapor, solid to liquid phase. What is vaporization? Liquid to vapor phase. What is sublimation? Solid to vapor phase. So in all the phase change processes, we have to find out the property, and the temperature and pressure remains constant. So for any phase change process, temperature pressure remains constant while the entropy and volumes are changing. And we take any general case of phase change. So initial phase I, final phase F. So the x is the quantity or fraction of the initial phase. So fraction of the initial phase. So the I is the initial phase which has been transferred to the final phase. Say for example, the water is converted into steam. We take water is converted into steam. Water is the initial phase and the steam is the final phase, and x is the quantity of the initial phase, that is quantity of water. So in any at any particular time in the process of converting liquid into vapor or water into steam, x is the quantity of the water available. If you have steam completely, x equal to 0 in a phase change process. The final phase, liquid phase to vapor phase, when you have completely vapor phase and x equal to, actually it is completely vapor, so there is no more water particle here. So that is what the x value. So the entropy change equal to 1 minus x into s of initial phase plus x into s of final phase. Then specific volume change, 1 minus x into Vi in plus x into Vf, where s and v are the linear functions of x value. For reversible phase transition, the heat transfer per mole or per kg is a latent heat. So for phase change process, the amount of heat input is given as latent heat. So latent heat is defined as temperature into the final entropy minus initial entropy. So this is what the change of the that is what amount of heat transferred for phase change, that is called as latent heat, and this is indicates the phase change. Any phase you can take SF equal to entropy of steam minus SI equal to entropy of water. If it is solid to liquid, so the in final phase is liquid phase, right? Entropy of the water minus entropy of the ice. So the change in entropy, final entropy minus initial entropy, multiplied by the temperature, that is what the amount of heat supply, that is known as latent heat of the phase change. And if we take the Gibbs function per unit mass, dg equal to minus s into dt plus v into dp. V is the specific volume, s is the specific entropy, and s equal to minus of dou g by dou t at constant pressure, and v equal to specific volume equal to dou g by dou p at constant temperature. And for your phase change, first order, the phase change is the first order, is known as the phase change with that satisfy the following requirement. A phase change of the first order is known as any phase change that satisfy the following requirement. So any phase change process that has to satisfy the following requirement. There is no change in the there are changes in the entropy and volume, and the first order derivative of Gibbs function change discontinuously. And using the first TdS equation, so TdS equal to Cv into dt plus T into dou p by dou t at constant volume dV. And for phase transition, which is reversible, isothermal and isobaric, reversible, isothermal, isobaric, and integrating over the whole range of the phase change. So this equation T into integrating this TdS equation, T into entropy, final entropy minus initial entropy into dt, T into dp by dt into dv is changing. This dv is final volume and initial volume. So temperature is constant and dp by dt is also constant. So dp by dt, so this integrating, so this dp by dt rearranging, T into sf minus si divided by vf, T into vf minus vi, and this already we defined, numerator is already we defined, T into sf minus si equal to latent heat of the phase change divided by T into vf minus vi. So vf is the final volume, specific volume, minus vi is the initial specific volume. So this equation is called as Clausius-Clapeyron equation. So the change in pressure with respect to temperature, we said pressure and temperatures are constant. So the dp by dt, the slope of the line dp by dt, that is equal to L by T into Vf minus Vi. That is what the latter, that is what the Clausius-Clapeyron equation, which defines, which is used for the to calculate the parameters of the phase change process. And the point to remember here, so we have to derive the Joule-Kelvin effect, explain the Joule-Kelvin effect, and derive the Joule-Kelvin coefficient mu j, and we have to derive the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. So these are all important for exam point of view. And these are all the books I referred for preparing the slides. You can also refer to it for additional information. And if you have any queries or comments on the slide and the presentation, you can write to my mail ID. I will answer to your queries. Thank you for watching, and we will meet again.